people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. Nepal has plunged into a deep political crisis after President Bidya Devi Bhandari, on recommendation of Prime Minister KP Sharma Oli, dissolved the lower house of the parliament, a move that has drawn widespread criticism, with opposition terming it illegitimate and unconstitutional. And now, when the opposition is demanding a rollback, Oli is all prepared to launch his campaign for snap elections, which under the current scenario are expected to be scheduled in April and May next year.
In a shocking wind-up to the months of internal rifts within the ruling Communist Party of Nepal, the lower house of parliament was dissolved on the recommendation of Prime Minister KP Sharma Oli on 20th December. Various reports that were later confirmed by a cabinet minister himself suggested that Oli took the hasty decision to prevent a no-confidence motion that was being planned by the faction loyal to Pushpa Kamal Dahal, a former PM who has now been appointed the parliamentary leader of the Communist Party.
Sarkarle ke chai testo naramro kaam gareko thiyo jasle garda ekdam ekka bihanai dauda daud garera एउटा प्रयोजनको निम्ति गरिएको हस्ताक्षरलाई कपी पेस्ट गरेर टाँसेर अविश्वासको प्रस्तावको लिखित तयार गर्नुपर्ने कारण के थियो?
President has also announced that general elections would be held in April and May, more than a year ahead of the schedule. Under the current scenario, neither of Oli or Dahal is in a position to form the government on his own. Prime Minister Oli, who according to many observers has made a calculated move by taking such a decision, is already asking his party leaders to mobilize the workers. Oli's party had emerged as the single largest party in 2017 with a little over 3.1 million popular votes. And analysts say that it won't be making much gain even if its popularity hasn't declined. But in spite of several socio-economic and development factors playing a key role in the elections, Oli believes that he can secure majority on his own.
Kamti ma 50 lakh lokpriya vote. 50 lakh lokpriya vote lyaunu parnech. Samanupatik ma ginti huncha tyo. Tyo 50 lakh kamse kam hamile vote lyaunu parnech.
The opposition parties in Nepal that have been protesting against the government for not being proactive enough even during the pandemic have cried foul and called it an unconstitutional move. They have sought immediate restoration of pre-dissolution time. However, it appears uncertain. The Supreme Court has sent the matter to the Constitutional Bench, which will only be delivering its verdict after a few weeks. people of the country who are bound to suffer said that the ruling party should have tried out other political combinations to run the country instead of calling an untimely election when its tourism-dependent economy has been battered by the pandemic.
We are now joined by Samantha Dehel, a lawyer who will touch upon the legal aspects of the crisis. So, Mr. Dehel, were constitutional provisions followed in dissolving the lower house of the parliament?
I think to get into the depth of this dissolution exercise that the current prime minister and the president has taken, we need to first of all understand the practice and convention of house dissolution. In the parliamentary form of government, which follows the Westminsterial Convention, dissolution of the House of Representatives by the Prime Minister is often considered to be an integral part of an integral power of Prime Minister's prerogative exercise of power. Moreover, this prerogative power that the Prime Minister can exercise to dissolve the Parliament is often declared to be unfettered if the Prime Minister is representing the majority party in the Parliament, regardless the size of the majority. A minority prime minister, on the other hand, if the government is led by a minority leader of the parliament, in that case, on the other hand, the power is not considered absolute, and there are some control and limit on which by when a minority leader who is a prime minister can exercise the power.
How will it impact the implementation of constitution in the coming days, as it is widely claimed to set a wrong precedent?
It was just passed 5 years back, and not all the provisions of the Constitution, especially dealing with the federalism side of it, has gone on to implementation. And in this scenario, taking this bold and a brazen move to undermine the provisions of the Constitution will definitely impact its livingness, its implementation, and its smooth implementation. So that is a clear view that I can give. Because, you know, the 1990 Constitution also, it suffered in 1994 when the then Prime Minister Girija Prasad Koirala tried to, dissolve the House. So, and then the Constitution did not last for long, and we had to scrap it entirely in 2006. So, there could be a situation that if this Constitution is also not honestly implemented, then its life will also be undermined in that regard. And if it's a wrong precedent or not, I would say doing so will set a wrong precedent, because other prime ministers and other presidents will also try to use it as a stick against the parliament whenever they think they're threatened from the parliament or their party members. So it will definitely set a wrong precedent. Now, coming to the question whether this house can be restated or not, the legal way to restate the house is definitely through a Supreme Court judgment. And only the Supreme Court can really restate the house, you know, declaring the move by the prime minister and the president unconstitutional.
Moving on. India is doubling down on its efforts to store and distribute vaccines whenever they are out. The government has also agreed for emergency authorization to candidates like Pfizer and AstraZeneca, and it will be rolling out these vaccines in any week of January. Country's indigenous and reasonable candidate Covaxin is in final stage, and the storage units across the country are working tirelessly to enhance their capacity.
Hospitals in Indian capital New Delhi are making arrangements for storage of coronavirus vaccine by installing freezers and setting up cold chain equipment. Over 100 freezers have been brought to Rajiv Gandhi Super Speciality Hospital. The country is making robust supply chain arrangements to ensure that the doses of the coronavirus vaccine reach its 1.3 billion people. India's largest airport plans to start distributing COVID-19 vaccines in January with up to 5.4 million vials a day.
It can be stocked with dry ice for 30 days and at 2 to 8 degree C for 5 days. So total 35 days is available for the distribution, which should be sufficient. So we are definitely geared up for that.
The Indian government is considering emergency use authorization for 3 vaccine candidates, one from AstraZeneca, another from Pfizer, and a separate one developed by the Indian firm Bharat Biotech. Hyderabad-based Bharat Biotech is developing Covaxin with the government-run Indian Council of Medical Research, which is the country's first indigenously developed vaccine candidate. The government says it will roll out the vaccine only after it is found safe. The dates could be any week in the month of January.
शायद जनवरी के महीने में भी कभी किसी भी स्टेज पे किसी भी सप्ताह में ऐसा समय आ सकता है जब हम भारत के लोगों को पहला जो वैक्सीन का शॉट है वो देने की स्थिति में आ जाए।
While India is second most hit country due to coronavirus, it has successfully contained the spread in past few weeks. From a daily count of nearly 100,000 positives, the country's everyday infections have come down below 30,000. Meanwhile, the authorities have announced a suspension of all flights originating from the United Kingdom to the country until the end of the year, amid growing global concerns over a highly infectious new strain of the coronavirus. India plans to track down everyone arriving from Britain over the past month, hoping to stop a more infectious strain of the coronavirus detected there, spreading in a country battling the world's second highest COVID-19 tally.
Moving on. Massive protests have erupted against Pakistan establishment over the mysterious death, which the protesters call a state killing, of Baloch rights activist and a pioneer of women rights in Balochistan, Karima Baloch. Karima, who was living in exile in Canada for over 4 years, had gone missing on 20th December and was found dead the next day in a canal in Toronto. Baloch accused the Pakistan establishment and the deep state of army behind her death.
ये जो दहशतगर्दी है
इसके पीछे मर्दी है।
ये जो दहशतगर्दी है
इसके पीछे मर्दी है।
Carrying pictures of Karima Baloch and floats accusing Pakistan establishment of sponsoring her murder in Canada, tens of thousands of demonstrating Balochs are in a state of shock and grief.
Karima, mere khoon se!
They say Karima's loss is no short of a devastation in their lives. They have now urged an immediate United Nations intervention into what they call a killing at the behest of Islamabad. Rights activists and observers say that this case is no more of a pattern that involves mysterious deaths of Pakistani dissidents who become a challenge to Islamabad's unbridled human rights violations. And Karima wasn't the first. The ISI and Pakistan Army are accused of eliminating several human rights activists in the past. Sajid Hussain, a Baloch journalist, was found dead earlier this year in similar circumstances in Sweden.
The cold-blooded murder of Baloch leader Banu Karima Baloch is totally unacceptable for Baloch people. It is a matter of grave concerns for us that Baloch activists who are not safe in Balochistan and to raise their voice if they leave the country, the ISI goons, their assassins, their target killers, they chase us. They have chased Baloch in Kandahar. You have heard about Gulbahar Bukhti and his son. Before that, many Baloch refugees in Afghanistan are target killed. And you have heard about Sajid Hussain. He was an eminent journalist and he was killed mysteriously. Till now, we don't know what happened.
Karima's speeches and appeals had not only resonated with discriminated and deprived Balochs, but she had become a prominent face in the international alleys while leading the Baloch movement at the United Nations. Once hailed by BBC as one of the most influential women on earth, Karima was a pioneer of women's rights too. She was a fearless critic of Pakistan's establishment and its army. She had also raised apprehensions over a large number of retired Pakistanis settling in Canada. The Canadian police, without really doing a thorough investigation, has ruled out a foul play in her death. Observers have raised doubts on intentions. Amnesty International have sought an effective probe.
A thorough investigation!
Investigate!
Exiled Balochs in European American countries say they have grown fearful of these systematic attacks and the governments must protect them.
We want justice! We want justice! We want justice!
There must be a thorough investigation because this is something that creating fear among the Baloch diaspora for their safety and security. Because the Baloch, they fled their country to be secure in West and to raise their voice against the injustices that are happening in Balochistan with their people. But now, since the Baloch have become victim of extrajudicial abduction and killing in Western countries, countries like Sweden and Canada, that raises serious concerns.
The Balochs in Pakistan are anyway considered second-class citizens. Over the years, Islamabad has systematically exploited the region of its vast minerals and resources. The locals never received their due. Those who dared to speak against the wrong were silenced. A crackdown was launched against the political activists, prompting many to flee the country and take refuge in West. Those who couldn't escape were subjected to barbarity.
Justice for! Justice for!
Today, Balochistan finds itself among the region with highest number of enforced disappearances. Even the women and children have not been spared. Only those who have fallen in line with Islamabad's oppressive rule are not harmed. Those who have dared to speak have been tortured, imprisoned or have met the fate similar to Karima Baloch.
Moving on. People in the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan demonstrated against the administration for long and painful load shedding. They said their region is enduring up to 20 hours of power cuts. The government had promised uninterrupted supply of electricity to the people but never paid heed to their needs after coming to power.
A transmission tower was set on fire by locals in Gilgit-Baltistan, citing it was of no use as the region was not getting any power. While a large number of the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan receives just 5 to 6 hours of electricity in a day, remaining does not get even that. Locals who held a demonstration against the government said that they were duped into installing smart meters at their homes but never given adequate power supply. The meter with unnecessary features charges more than the conventional rates. They want them removed.
हम ने आज यहां पे احتجاج किया है कल हम आरसीसी चौक पर احتجاج करेंगे अगर फिर भी हमारे मुतालिबात नहीं माने गए तो हम सेक्रेटरी वाटर एंड पावर के दफ्तर का घेराव करेंगे और हम عوامی तौर पर मीटर तोड़ो मुहिम का आगाज करेंगे यह जो स्मार्ट मीटर नामी एक चीज हमारे ऊपर मुसल्लत की गई है इसको हम तोड़ देंगे गवर्नमेंट के मुंह पे मारेंगे ऐसी चीजों को
Gilgit-Baltistan, a region under Pakistan's illegal occupation, is among the top regions in the world with maximum electricity generation potential. home to some giant soaring rivers and gigantic glaciers. The region is blessed with abundance of water resources, thus making it a suitable destination for hydropower generation projects. However, due to the absence of a political will, deep-rooted corruption and systematic discrimination by the authorities, the residents are deprived of proper supply of electricity. The available sources of power cater mostly to the people of Pakistan and not the region.
पूरे गिलगित बल्तिस्तान में बिजली का इशू है उस पे ये हुआ कि स्मार्ट मीटर नामी चीज जो कराची में रिजेक्टेड हुआ था सुप्रीम कोर्ट के फैसले से उसको लाके यहाँ पे मुसल्लत किया गया नगर कॉलोनी से लेकर सकारगुई तक स्मार्ट मीटर लगाए गए इन शराइत पे लगाए गए कि इनको 24 घंटे बिजली दी जाएगी फ्री जोन लोड शेडिंग फ्री जोन बनाया जाएगा लेकिन वक्त के साथ साथ इन फिरौनों ने इस बिजली को काट के अपने नुमाइंदे जो बैठे हुए हैं उनको बिजलियां देनी शुरू की और अब इस टाइम ये हाल है कि यहाँ पे 18-18 घंटा बिजली चली जाती है और जहाँ पे लोग इस टैक्स को देते नहीं है बिजली के बिल को देते नहीं है वहाँ पे बिजली के लोग मजे ले रहे हैं.
Most of Gilgit-Baltistan's electricity revenue is exhausted as salaries and perks to the Pakistani officials, and a minuscule of it is allotted for the development of the ongoing projects. Authorities use cheap and outdated machinery along with substandard material that leads to the downfall of the efficiency of the power plants. Residents complain that the electricity crisis is deepening day by day, as it is not only affecting their day-to-day lives but also their health and employment.
Festivals in India are an occasion to celebrate and mingle with friends and family members. Christmas was celebrated in India with religious fervor amid the coronavirus pandemic. Let's take a look at celebrations.
It's a festive season. Shops and markets across India are decked up to celebrate Christmas, the birth of Jesus Christ, and New Year. Celebrations in India are marked by glittery street decorations, exchange of gifts, cakes, and Christmas carols. Due to the coronavirus pandemic, the celebration this year were a low-key affair with adherence to all the social distancing norms and to prevent the spread of the virus.
I'm very happy to see all the people, like from different communities, from different backgrounds, but still we are celebrating Christmas in very peacefully manner, in very harmony.
In Northeast India, churches were decorated to celebrate the festival, but the entry was restricted inside the churches due to the pandemic. The whole setup of Jesus Christ's birth was created and decorated beautifully with stars, lights, bells, and Christmas trees.
I take this opportunity to wish all the viewers a very happy Christmas. And as you all know that Christmas is the commemoration of the birth of Jesus in this world. And he had everything in heaven, but obeying the Father's command, he chose to be born amidst us. And now we call that Jesus is a God who chose to be born amidst us.
People get together and spend quality time with their family members.
The preparation this year, I could say, yes, the mood is on, but it is still less than last year. The crowd what you find in this market is comparatively less as from last year.
In Bengaluru city of South India, a 10-day cake exhibition is being organized as part of Christmas celebrations. The event showcases varieties of cakes in various shapes and themes.
It's too beautiful. They fall too much to work. All the cakes are like here, a Doraemon cake. And after Corona, we came here. We didn't went to any events. Very happy to tell this. They did a good
Though the festival of Christmas comes to an end, New Year celebrations are continuing in India and the rest of the world.
Celebrated on the 25th day of the month of December every year, Christmas is a time to spread joy, love and cheer with your family and friends. With that colourful note, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.